I know I have a habit of speaking too quickly, so I will try and go as slow as I can. But if I do run away, please do give me a shout. Please also be warned that I have two young kittens somewhere in the house and I'm unable to shut my door. So at some stage, I may be ambushed. So please bear with me if that happens. Okay, so to start, I'm just going to share my screen. Hopefully, this will work. I've got a message saying the host has disabled screen sharing. Is it possible to get that remedied so I can share my screen? There we go. Thank you. Okay, so I think some of this early introduction has already kindly been dealt with, so I can go relatively quickly. So briefly, for those of you who are unaware of what Lead 8 is, we are a London-based law firm with many traditional forms of legal practice that many of you will be aware of, you know, employment and the like. We also have an international department, as has already been touched on, where we specialize in claims typically either brought against British multinationals or the British government on behalf of individuals who have been harmed internationally. I have been with the firm for over 10 years. I joined as a paralegal. So, for those of you who are not in the legal profession, that is an unqualified junior lawyer. And I have subsequently trained and qualified with the firm. The case I'm going to talk to you about, as already been said, is the Mau Mau claims. So, this was a claim that I've worked on since the start of my career, all the way through its lifespan, with two senior lawyers that we have here at Lee Day, Martin Day, who is the founder of our law firm, and Daniel Leader, who is a partner at the law firm who I continue to work with to this day. So, as has already been touched on, these claims arise out of the Kenya emergency. So, that was a state of emergency that was declared in Kenya during the 1950s and lasted for a period of 8 years. During that period, the British authorities, alongside the British Army, created a very comprehensive system of detention, interrogation, a whole system and network of camps across what was Central Province in Kenya. And as you'll see on the slide here, it's considered that as many as 150,000 suspected members of the resistance, the struggle, were detained in those camps. Caroline Elkins, who is a historian who's written about the emergency extensively, actually approximates that if you include the enforced villages, so this is where individuals were forced to live within villages that were surrounded by fencing and security guards, that number actually increases to over 1 million. So it was a very significant operation over a very prolonged period of time. And effectively, what would happen is individuals would be captured, arrested, and then interrogated for information. What was key to the British authorities and security services at this time was to force people into a confession. And so severe mistreatment and torture was part of their way of extorting that. So the claims were brought on behalf of five lead claimants. So these are Ndika Mutua. So he is on the left of your screen, and Paolo Enzili. Paolo and Ndiku are both members of the Kamba tribe in Kenya. Predominantly, the insurgency was focused on the Kikuyu tribe, but it did extend into other tribes in Kenya, particularly the Kamba. The Kamba had a long history of working with the British military authorities. So when the British became aware that the Kamba were also involved in the insurgency, they were particularly aggressive with their stamping out of that within the Kamba. That led to some very severe incidences of mistreatment. Both Ndiku and Paolo suffered castrations at the hands of the authorities. We then have Susan Engondi and Jane Mara, both of whom were detained by the British authorities and very severely sexually abused. They had a means of basically abusing people with bottles, some with extremely hot water inside. And then the last individual we have on the left is Wambugu Nyengi. So Wambugu was actually held, he was arrested quite early on in the emergency and held almost throughout the entirety. And he was involved in a very significant event which was covered internationally called the Hola Massacre. So this was an event where I think about a group of 11 or 12 detainees were taken from the detention camp. They were given instructions of forced labor. And when they were refused, they were very severely beaten. I think 10 individuals were killed. Wambugu is the only survivor from that incident. And he only survived because they beat him unconscious and they believed he was dead. He woke up in the morgue, and he thankfully survived and was able to join part of the cause in terms of seeking reparations. So briefly, in terms of the claims started in June 2009. The British government challenged those claims. They challenged them on 2 points. The first was that there was no claim against the British government in law. I wouldn't go too far into the technicalities because obviously we're dealing with multiple jurisdictions here and each country is going to have their own legal hurdles. But in a nutshell, the issue here is that the British government was effectively arguing that everything that happened in Kenya was done in right of the Crown in Kenya, a different legal entity, that the British government was not involved in what had happened. It's a very technical legal argument. That was the issue that we dealt with first in April 2011, and thankfully the courts found in our favour. The second issue was that the government raised the defence of limitation, which is what we're here to talk about today. And so that issue came to light in 2012. And again, thankfully, we were able to make our representations successfully, and the court found in our favour. I should emphasise that in both of these instances, we are talking about preliminary hearings as opposed to a full trial. In England, the burden is lower in a preliminary hearing. In a full trial, we need to argue our case on the balance of probabilities, whereas for these preliminary hearings, the bar is lower. Essentially, we have to just evidence that our claim is arguable. So it's much easier to win at that early level as opposed to at a full trial. We were very fortunate during the proceedings in that the cases garnered a significant amount of media coverage. This was not just from newspapers that we would consider perhaps traditional allies that would write about such issues. Here we have three front pages from the Times, which I think most people would consider to be, a centre conservative establishment newspaper. So it was quite something that it was picked up by the Times and also other newspapers that traditionally lie more on the right that would be protecting the government from these allegations. And this amount of attention is important, as we said earlier in the introduction. Whilst this is a legal claim, it was much broader than that. There were political issues at stake. So the fact that the claims garnered a significant amount of attention was very important in putting pressure onto the British government. So, following the success of the two preliminary hearings, with limitation being found in favour in 2012, we then moved our work into Kenya, where for the best part of a year, we travelled extensively around Kenya, interviewing other victims. I think in total, we interviewed roughly about 20,000 individuals, and we were able to accept instructions on behalf of just over 5,200. And I will come back to this later, but this is important because, as you'll see, we started the case with the five, and as we built the momentum and built the success, we've expanded that and built upon it. After we had the first and second hearings, and whilst we were conducting our investigations, we were able to engage the British government in settlement negotiations. I obviously can't say too much about that, but these were twin tracks whilst the British government was preparing its appeal against the hearings that had gone against it, and we were also preparing the cases to trial. So the litigation was progressing at court whilst we were simultaneously investigating the claims and building up the cohort larger, and at the same time conducting negotiations with the British government. As some of you may already know, we were able to successfully resolve the claims. That was announced in June 2013. So having increased the size of the cohort, we were able to obtain compensation for over 5,000 victims. These were individuals who, like our lead clients, had been detained and severely abused by the British authorities and security services in Kenya. The British government also made a statement of regret and funded the construction of a memorial in Uhuru Park in Nairobi, Kenya. For those of you who don't know, Uhuru actually means freedom. So that's Freedom Park in Nairobi. So that's some context of the legal case. And I suppose I'll return now to the main issue which everybody's here to discuss, which is limitation. So I won't go into too much detail again, because obviously we're talking across jurisdictions and the specifics will be very different. But in terms of the situation that we had for these cases, for cases such as these, limitation is 3 years. So you have 3 years from the date of the incident, or the date that you have not sufficient knowledge to bring a claim to start this at court. The court as well, though, does have a discretion in claims like these. So if you're unable to bring it within that 3 year period, you can argue your case before the court that it should exercise its discretion and allow the cases to proceed. That's not the entire story, I suppose, in that, as you'll have seen, the limitation started in 1952. And went up to 1960. We were also dealing with a piece of legislation which provides for an absolute time bar. And that affects events that go, I think, midway into 1954. So we were unable to bring any claims that predated that. It's an absolute statute bar, so we were unable to bring those forward. So we were only looking at incidents that happened when the Limitation Act 1980 came into force, that we could bring the claims under that regime. And again, we were relying on the discretion. So as you'll see from the slide, the British government were arguing that the claims should be dismissed on the basis that they were time barred because we hadn't brought them in time. Whereas we and the claimants accepted that they had not been started within that statutory deadline, but we sought to convince the court that due to the particular facts of these claimants, the reasons why they hadn't been able to bring their cases sooner, and the fact that we argued a fair trial could still be held, the court should exercise its discretion and allow the claims to proceed. So during the proceedings, this is during the July 2012 hearing, the parties agreed that the primary issue before the court was this issue of whether or not a fair trial could still be held, this being some 50 years plus since these events happened. The British government unsurprisingly argued that a fair trial could not be held. Their argument was based on the fact that they said, you know, key witnesses were no longer available, and that, you know, the documentary evidence was insufficient. We, on the other hand, argued that a fair trial was still available, pointing to the extensive archival evidence that existed, as well as the supportive evidence that we had got to support our clients' cases. So that was expert evidence on their injuries, supportive evidence in terms of contemporaneous documents, and any other witnesses who could give supporting evidence as to what had happened to those individuals. On this, we were very lucky, and that during the proceedings, it came to light that the British government had actually migrated significant tranche of documents out of Kenya on independence. These had not been released into the public archives, and they had been hidden away, the government says by mistake, in a secret archive, and those documents came to light. So we had the benefit of this additional information, and that also gave more, I would say, more traction to the media attention that was coming forward at that time. So as I've already touched on, the court found in favor of our clients in July 2012, finding that a fair trial was still possible, and this was based on the cogency of the evidence and the documentation that had been put forward, also the availability of witnesses that were still alive to that date. So that's a brief overview of the claims themselves. Obviously, they're much more complicated than that, and we could probably spend all afternoon talking about the work that we did, but we don't have that time. So I've tried to just give as brief overview as I can to give you some context of how we got from the start of the case to the resolution. And I will now try and tease some kind of strategic and practical lessons out. Before I do that, I should also say, though, that during the introduction, it was touched upon kind of issues of international public law and their application to limitation periods. I myself am a private law lawyer. That's not my area of expertise. But during the July 2012 hearing, submissions on public international law and their impact on limitation in cases such as these were made by an NGO called Redress. Unfortunately, those arguments were not successful. But if anybody is interested in those submissions and the court's reasoning on its conclusions, I would suggest reading the judgment from the 2012 hearing. Moving now on to the lessons that we can draw from our experience of the Mau Mau claims. Number one, I would say it's incredibly important to be very careful with the cohort of clients that you are representing and the scope of the claims. We are not the only case that was brought forward that arises from the Mau Mau, from the Mau Mau victims and the Kenya emergency. There was a follow-on claim that was brought on behalf of over 40,000 clients. That case went to a full trial and unfortunately lost, with decisions being made in 2018. So there are clear, I would say, distinctions between the strategy that we employed and the strategy that those working on the other case employed. We were always very conscious of how much we were asking of the court to find in favor of our clients. I think with most lawyers, and I appreciate not everyone here will be a lawyer, the notion of obtaining a finding by the court that a fair trial is still possible 50 years plus after the event is a very big ask. We were conscious of how much we were asking the court, so we wanted to make it as easy as possible in that regard. Now, that meant some difficult decisions. We would obviously want to help anybody who was mistreated during this period, but we had to be very conscious that if you're putting the case before the court, there is obviously going to be a very significant difference in the court's attitude between addressing the claim of an individual who's been very severely tortured and the claim of an individual who has been perhaps detained unlawfully, they allege, or otherwise, but suffered either no physical violence or relatively low-level physical violence. So we were very careful and we made sure that when we put the lead cases forward, we were putting forward the strongest claims, those that would grab the court's attention. And that is why the lead five clients were selected. I think it's also important to consider the scope of the claims that you're bringing. The claims that we were bringing were limited to personal injuries and the injuries and consequential, injuries of that. Whereas the scope of the claims in the follow-up claims were much wider. So they were looking at issues of, I think, financial losses, also the legality of whether or not someone was detained legally or otherwise. So those were much more complicated questions, both legally and evidentially, that they were putting to the court. Whereas by narrowing our cohort and the issues that we were putting forward, we were giving the court only the most significant and, I suppose, arguably easiest questions to wrestle with. Point number two is to work within the framework. I would say that, in these scenarios, you have two options. One is simply to challenge the application of limitation, full stop. Obviously, there is value in that strategy, but I think anyone pursuing it would recognize that completely challenging the disapplication will be a much bigger ask than working within the legal framework that exists, whilst obviously seeking to push it as far as you can, but recognizing you are working within that legal framework. As I already touched upon, we did, I suppose, do simultaneous. We did seek to argue that the limitation with the help of redress shouldn't be applied. That part of the claim was lost. The successful element of the claims were treating the claims as personal injury claims under the limitation framework and being very sure that we were ticking all of the right boxes to ensure that we met the thresholds that were required. I think sometimes with claims that are as emotive as these, it can be easy to lose sight of the technicalities because there is that moral outrage that these individuals should get a remedy. That is utterly understandable. But it's also very important to not lose sight of the framework that you're working under. I suppose building on what I've already said about trying to make things easier for the court, we were very careful on that front. It was an important element for the claims, for the court to exercise its discretion, that we explained the reason for the delay. So we ensured that our client's witness evidence gave an account of why there had been a delay. Unfortunately, the other claims that followed did not. That was part of the reasoning why they were dismissed. Another important point was doing as much as we could to recognize the period of time and trying, I suppose, to fill in the gaps. We don't have their individual detention records. We don't have their contemporaneous medical assessments. Not that there probably would be any. So we had to do what we could to fill in those gaps. So we ensure that they were assessed by experts that could write reports that, their accounts were consistent with their scarring, trying to bolster their accounts. We also spoke with individuals who had been detained with them, individuals that could talk to what happened, support their accounts. Again, giving the court confidence about the cogency of the evidence. that this was not just a shot in the dark, that the evidence could be considered and challenged. In addition to that, it was meticulously going through what evidence there was there in terms of the archival documentation. And I suppose that brings me to the next point, which is about sharing a load. It's about recognizing again how difficult these cases are. And I think there is that adage that, you know, sharing a problem obviously makes it easier to solve that problem. We were very fortunate in that we did not bring these claims on our own. We not only worked with a brilliant group of barristers who were able to, you know, distill the huge amount of information and evidence to the court in a very digestible way. It was about everybody else that helped us. We worked with the Mau Mau War Veterans Association, who was critically important in organizing the veterans, getting that wider support base. We worked with the Kenya Human Rights Commission, who again was critical in arranging and managing the clients, facilitating their travel from Kenya, facilitating their assessments of medical attention in Kenya, also kind of reaching out to wider stakeholders and getting the message out there in terms of what was going on and shining that spotlight. We worked with a group of historians. I've mentioned Caroline Elkins before. They were two very well-respected academics who had previously written about the detention practices in Kenya during this period. That was Professor Caroline Elkins and Professor David Anderson. We also worked with a third academic, Dr. Hugh Bennett, who was a military historian. They were not only able to act as our guides through the archival evidence, but we were fortunate enough to have witness statements submitted on their behalf where they were able to digest the significance of that information and communicate it to the court. Again, it was about making the court's job as easy as possible. But I would say all of those organizations, so the Mau Mau War Veterans Association, the historians, the Kenya Human Rights Commission, they also had a very important role to play, not only in the litigation, but the broader effort, I think, which was critically important in terms of getting the story out there, in terms of getting that media attention. Journalists aren't always that interested in talking to lawyers. Not everyone thinks particularly highly of us. But having the victims there who could talk directly, having NGOs and historians who could get that message out there, I think was very important in terms of building that critical momentum within the media. And I would say that was very important in terms of reaching the settlement we did. It also played a critical role, I think, within the proceedings, in that another key distinction between the hearing that we did on limitation and the full trials of the follow-on claims is that because of the weight of media interest in what was happening, the British government took the very unusual step of simply accepting our clients' evidence. We suspect that they did not want the victims to be cross-examined in court. That would have led to further negative press. So to avoid that, they accepted the client's evidence. That was a very important point in our client's favor, in terms of why a fair trial was still possible. The UK government didn't make that same acceptance in the follow-on case, which didn't have the same amount of media scrutiny or attention. And so the government lawyers were able to cross-examine the witnesses. There were evidence issues over the consistency of their evidence. You know, it undermined their case that a fair trial was still possible. I suppose those are the broad points. I suppose the one point I would say, again, just referring back to the issue of strengthening the cohort, was that, another very difficult decision we made was in terms of, it was critically important to us that we were representing individuals who were still alive, people who could give their evidence to the court themselves. We started off with the five lead clients, who I spoke about earlier. Sadly, Susan Ngondi passed away before she was able to give her evidence. So of those cases that progressed, it was only Susan's who we were unsuccessful with. And that was because she had passed away and she was not able to give her evidence to the court. That was critically important to the court in terms of judging why a fair trial was still possible. I appreciate that was a whistle-stop tour. And because I'm sharing my screen, I can't actually see how long I've spoken for. So, apologies if I've either finished a bit too quick or if I have rumbled on for a bit too long.